Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tim Johnson. I'm Associate Director for Museum Programs here at the National Museum of the American Indian. I also serve as a member of the Executive Committee of the Smithsonian's Living in the Anthropocene Initiative, which is the Smithsonian Institution's consortia effort to better understand this new geologic era in which humans are the dominant force impacting and shaping the state of the Earth. As a moderator of today's program, I welcome you to On the Table, Creating a Healthy Food Future. This is the National Museum of the American Indian's 9th annual Living Earth Symposium. Can't believe, Elizabeth, it's been that many already. The symposium takes place as part of our museum's Living Earth Festival, which celebrates native philosophies, traditions, and cultural arts linking humans to the natural world, that examines how to preserve and protect and secure sustainable practices, and that explores the causes and remedies to environmental concerns, such as climate change, that affect all peoples living on the Earth. In today's symposium, we'll be focusing on innovative ways to build a healthy and resilient food future that will include lively presentations and followed by conversation about sustainable farming, the impacts of genetically modified organisms, otherwise known as GMOs, the conservation of heritage seeds, and traditional indigenous approaches that seek to maintain empathic connections to our living Earth. This is a vitally important topic, and we look forward to a spirited and intellectually engaging program. Now, before our program begins, just a few housekeeping reminders. Please, if you have a cell phone, take this opportunity to turn it off. We're also webcasting this program, and interruptions not only distract our distinguished presenters, but they make for bad television also. So please turn off your phones. After our last presentation this afternoon, our speakers will be assembled at center stage, and we'll have a question and answer panel discussion. So please hold all your questions until all of the speakers have made their presentations. Now it's my great pleasure to introduce Ricardo Salvador. Dr. Salvador, who is descended from indigenous Zapotec and German-American farming families, is an internationally renowned agronomist with more than 20 years of experience working to build a healthier food system. As the senior scientist and director of the Food and Environment Program at the Union of Concerned Scientists, Dr. Salvador works with citizens, scientists, economists, and politicians to transform our present food system into one that grows healthy foods while employing sustainable practices. He previously served as a program officer for food health and well-being at the W.K. Kellogg Foundation, where he partnered with colleagues to create programs that address the connections between food and health, environment, economic development, sovereignty, and social justice. According to Dr. Salvador, a healthful food supply that is produced without exploiting people or nature is both an imperative and a realistic possibility. Today, he will describe the ways this can be brought about from the perspective of both agricultural science and Aboriginal knowledge. Please help me welcome Ricardo Salvador.
Appreciate that very kind introduction from Tim, and it's a great honor to be at this institution talking about this critical topic. One of the more important realizations about what science is that it's empiricism. It's a way of knowing, and it is a way of knowing about things that either work or don't work, that are subject to everyone's scrutiny in order to make the decision about whether things work or don't work, and not subject to just individual opinions. And there's a great deal about that description about a particular form of coming about with knowledge, which is what the modern concept of science is, and the way that ancient Aboriginal knowledge has been built up. Things work or they don't work, and whether things work or not has to do with how well one understands the planet as it is, the planet's life-giving systems as they're adjusting, and therefore how we must adjust to that. And so that's what I want to talk about. The good news is that the type of food system that Tim just described, one that is healthful, one that can be generated without exploiting either people or nature, is actually the type of food system that is better for all of us and which has the smallest footprint. We have been pursuing a path which is not emblematic of our understanding as a species, that we are contingent or dependent on the planet's life systems, and that what is helpful for the Earth and what is helpful for us are one and the same thing. So that when we undermine the health of the planet, we're also undermining our own health. And these are principles, as I've mentioned, not only of Aboriginal knowledge, as I hope to illustrate, but also principles of current scientific knowledge, with the issue being, of course, that we're not acting on that knowledge. And one of the reasons for that is that we tend to focus on the short term. Now, all of us as individuals can understand a phase of life when our understanding is limited by insufficient experience. And where because of that, we tend not to think about the future very much, about our own long term. There comes a time for all of us when we understand that the actions that we take today are going to affect our long term well-being. Do we have adequate savings? What will we do when we no longer can provide for our own livelihood? There comes a time when we understand that what we do today affects our health in the future. The amount of exercise that we take, the way that we eat, will eventually turn into what our health state is. And the period of time before that happens is adolescence, you know, where we actually don't realize that we won't always be young, juicy, succulent, resilient, strong. And so likewise, in the current era, we can make the analogy that we're behaving as adolescents, believing that we'll always have the abilities that we have at the current time, not realizing that we're drawing down on resources that we will need in the future. And so Aboriginal knowledge has, of course, accumulated the experience of thousands of years that inform us about how to be prepared about exactly that scenario. So I want to illustrate this with an example that is very personal. This is not only just a result of study, although it is that, and I'll describe that a little bit, but it also intertwines very much with personal experience. And so I'd like for you to take a look at the area where I was raised, and this is southern Mexico, and these are the mountains of a state called Oaxaca. And in this particular state, which is among Mexico's most indigenous states, there are about 16 different native peoples that live just in this one state alone. The largest are the Zapotec, known within the group as Beneza, cloud people. And the reason for that name, one can easily appreciate when you visit these areas, you can see often, particularly early in the morning, that the clouds are actually still in the deep valleys in between these mountain chains. So Zapotecs have been living in this era, in this area, for approximately about 8,000 years. And so that means that there's 8,000 years of experience in terms of answering the question, what is the best way to live here? And over this period of time, there's been a dramatic transition in the self-provisioning systems of Beneza. And the major transformation has been that initially, when Beneza settled this area, although the internal tradition is actually that they emerged from the earth, but when they began to provide for themselves, what they did was to gather. And so those plants that were gathered are actually still part of the food supply, but at one time they were the main source of the food supply, now they're supplementary sources of food. But everyone remembers what they are, and they are still in the agricultural fields. In agricultural fields of the Beneza, when these things appear, no one regards them as weeds. That concept is undefined because everything has a use. And in addition to that, there was hunting, very small game, so deer, rabbits, things of this sort, occasionally duck. Now, Over that period of time, there was a transition to cultivation of a plant, which you will see at the front of the museum, core to the subsistence of Veneza to this day, which is the corn plant. That happened about 5,000 years ago in that very part of Mexico. And together with the evolution of this particular plant with the people of the area, because that's what happened, they both shaped each other over a period of time, there was a system of understanding how to produce agriculturally so that the conditions that I described at the top of this conversation were met, and that is that people could provide for their own well-being without diminishing the well-being of the planet. And so that's the thing that I want to draw upon as an example. So here's an example of what modern cornfields look like in this area. You'll notice that one feature of them is that unless you're actually looking for them, you may actually miss them completely because of the fact that they actually integrate into the native canopy of the forest in which they're embedded. So there's no notion of clearing out entire swaths of forest to create this homogeneous area where all you have is just one species of plant. There are multiple species of plant. Now, the reason for this scientifically, and this is the reason why I can confidently reassert the claim that I made at the top of the conversation, which is that the footprint of the healthful system is the smallest footprint, is that this is a type of system that came about at a time when we could not cheat on energy. That means that we needed to derive more energy from the food system than what we expended in order to produce that food. You realize that if that minimum balance is not maintained, then you would essentially emaciate and eventually die. You needed to have a greater return to labor from the food that was produced than you were investing. That is most decidedly not the case at present for those of you that are experts or knowledgeable about the agricultural system, where we must expend about 8 to 10 times the amount of energy than we get back from the actual food, which is only possible not because we're magicians or because science is possible, it's because we're actually excavating the past for fossil energy and depleting that in order to be able to perform what appears to look like a miracle of productivity. But in this system, all the energy is real. It must be accounted for. It's utilized in real time. And the way that it's particularly useful is that this principle of operating with canopies that are deep, where there are tall trees that are usually fruit-bearing, with a tall corn canopy, which produces life-giving grain, that serves as a trellis on which legumes can climb, which then shades plants that actually need shade in order to be able to grow well, cucurbits, squashes, things of this sort. And so it's a system that's very productive, both per unit of labor as well as per unit of land. So modern contemporary scientific assessments tell us that they're as productive by just a little bit when compared to current systems where what you're comparing is the energy input as well as the land area required to as much as 6 times more productive than the modern blinking lights, shiny metal agricultural system that many of us think are the pinnacle of modernity. So they're very foolish systems in terms of the way that they actually utilize energy compared to a system like this one. But the development of this type of agricultural system was not instantaneous. It did take learning. It did take a period of time. Now, I'm going to be referring, as I mentioned, to personal experience. Here's Dad. Here's my great aunt who play a part in this story, actually in her garden. And this is a typical Veneza garden, where the idea of the garden is that it's not ornamental, it's not a beautiful thing to look at, it's producing food, or as she would say, it's working. And so this working garden is the source of food, so whenever we visit, at mealtime, we go out. Typically, you know, if you're gonna have lemonade, you take 5 steps and you get the lemons from which the lemonade is going to be made, and so on, for all of the sources of food, the tomatoes, the chilies, everything that you're gonna be eating. And I want to tell you a story that dates to this period of time. I was 16 years of age at this particular period when I was scolded by my great aunt Evarista, whom you just saw there, because I stepped on kernels of corn as I performed an errand that she had instructed me to perform, which was to feed the chicken. And so I was broadcasting the chickens that were just wandering around, actually on that very walk right there, and I stepped on the corn. And I received a lecture to the effect that one does not step on the source of life. And the reason why this is a germane story to this particular tale is that much, much later, when I was at university, you know, pursuing sophisticated studies, I actually ran into an ancient text that Spanish friars had collected from the time of the Spanish conquest of Mexico. It was not collected from Beneza, it was collected from the tradition of people who are now known to us as Aztecs, not what they call themselves, but in their traditions, there was exactly the same belief that corn was a source of life, and therefore you nurtured it, you respected it, and the last thing that you did was to step on it, and it was actually a curse to step on it. When I read that, those are almost exactly the same words of Aunt Evarista, which is just emblematic of the deeply ingrained empirical nature of developing Aboriginal knowledge. What works is preserved. So let me get into a description. Beneza culture, for those of you who are not familiar, first of all, still exists. There are 600,000 Beneza in Oaxaca. There's an indeterminate number of Beneza in Los Angeles. They are now on the migrant trail, and so they're the labor force for a lot of the farming that occurs north of there, harvesting vegetables and fruits that you and I may eat if they're grown in the area north of Los Angeles and Oxnard, Ventura, those areas. But at any rate, so it's thriving. And this is a shot of a place that many of you may have visited. It's actually on exhibit in some parts of this museum, at least a couple of years it was. Known in Zapotec as Liobat, which is the sky city. Supported thousands of people for almost 800 years, the first urban settlement of the American continent, which was possible because of the development of the type of agricultural system that I'm about to describe. Let me just get into that description very quickly after having established that the agricultural system was so successful that it actually nurtured the rise of urban civilization on the continent and actually an empire. There are dark aspects to this story as well, but the empire lasted nearly 1,000 years. And so these are shots actually from our native community, a place called Yatsachi in the Sierra Norte of the state of Oaxaca. Demonstrating early cultivation of corn and also the fact that you're doing this on soil that is very rich. For those of you that either have agronomy in your background or have a garden and can recognize the quality of soil when you look at it, but which is very precarious and could easily be wasted because it is on mountain slopes where that could easily be washed away if it isn't managed properly. And so as I mentioned, here is what a typical Beneza stand of maize would look like, which is producing lots of things simultaneously. Now, let me, here's another example of a deep canopy. Here you can see some banana thrown in there together with some of the climbing vines. And again, a typical lay of the topography where this is done, where it doesn't overtake the landscape. There's sufficient planted, then the rest of the landscape does what it does to retain the soil in place. So here is the agricultural cycle of Beneza that I want to describe, and it's probably, at least in my estimation, the most useful way of understanding the agricultural system that I'm both describing and recommending in place of something like we have operating at large scale and expanding, exported from the United States Midwest and from Central Europe to the rest of the world as if it were the pinnacle of agricultural advancement. So instead of that, let me describe this to you. So these are a combination of both personal experience as well as actual anthropological data collected by an anthropologist at the University of Michigan by the name of Kent Flannery, if you're interested in the example and then subsequently want to go see some of the data on your own. But what you see here is obvious running along the x-axis here. You have the run of the season. And then you have the distribution of rain. And the units won't be familiar to you in millimeters. The important thing is just to notice the distribution of the rain. Agricultural scientists match the growth pattern of the crop to the distribution of rain. It's a concept that's called phenology. So you can almost imagine what the matching growth pattern of the corn plant needs to be in order to match the availability of water. And so let me tell you that Beneza actually plant their corn, and the corn in Dijajon, which is the name of the language, is actually the name that you're applying to the stand of the crops. And you literally are saying that corn, but everybody who's Beneza understands that's where you're producing your food. So it's the whole pantry. It's the corn and everything else that's growing there. So you wouldn't understand that it's just monocrop corn. But it is the future crop. Everything depends on that plant. And so the corn is actually planted twice. So there is this first planting, which occurs in May, which you'll see is when the rain first begins to reach a threshold level where it can sustain growth. Then there is a second planting, which is about 30 days after this initial planting. Now, you may be formulating your own theories for why there's a couple of planting dates here, but let me just fill this out. If everything goes well, meaning if there's sufficient water, then at a particularly precarious time, the dog days of summer in August, is when pollination takes place. If pollination doesn't occur, there's no grain. So you're going for all the marbles in terms of what happens in August, which is completely out of your control. Although Benedza believe they have some agency, not control, but some agency by talking to the god of lightning. So after flowering, then you essentially wait for the grains to develop, and if everything goes well, you're gathering in October. So there should be nothing to surprise you here, but there'll be a couple of things at least to surprise you in terms of understanding the thinking that goes behind this. So here are two aunts of mine, Lucia and Lucila, and this is one of my favorite pictures because of the fact that they're out here actually planting the corn. You can see the armadillo shells on their belly from which they're grabbing a combination of corn, bean, and squash seeds. And just one fell swoop, they're moving through the field planting, and it looks like ballet when they're going through the field doing this. So let me illustrate what Benedza are thinking when they go through the cycle that you just saw. So they do their first planting, and then they observe. Sometimes in extreme emergencies, you actually harvest the first planting for people food. But that's very rare. Most of the time, you're just letting sheep and goats go in there and graze. You really only care about this planting for the first 30 days. And then after you've observed what's going to happen with this first planting, you do the main planting on the basis of how that first crop did. And here's what you do. So one outcome is that there's sufficient rain. One outcome is that there's deficient rain. Now, I taught for nearly 18 years at Iowa State University, and when I described the system to the future farmers of the state of Iowa, and I said, Kent Flannery, the anthropologist who looked at this system, when he did the study that I'm summarizing for you here, had an 80-year database of weather records of the Central Valley of Oaxaca. And he knew, these two numbers are the same, but it's just coincidental, he knew that the rainfall on the basis of those data predicted rainfall in the following growing season. So what happened during that month, that first month when you planted in May, predicted the likelihood that you were going to have adequate rain the rest of the season, 80% of the time. So, you know, if you knew when you had to determine how much seed to plant, how much rain there was going to be the rest of the season, would that be a useful tool, a useful piece of information to know how much to plant? An Iowa kid say, well, yes, definitely, it's obvious. If we knew how much it's going to rain, we would plant more. And so Benedza, when they know that it's going to rain plenty, they plant less. The population density is lower. And when they know that there's going to be deficient rain, they compensate for that by planting more individuals of corn. So that first crop is a diagnostic crop, and it's to figure out where are the likelihoods that this is going to be a good season or not. And the reason for this is that the whole goal of Benedza self-provisioning is to make sure that you have a supply for that year. And there's this internal self-talk that is actually reinforced when our parents and our grandparents speak to us that you only need what you need, and everybody else needs what they need. And if you take more of your share, there may be insufficient for people elsewhere. And that's important because sometimes they may have plenty, you may not have plenty, and you want them to be thinking of you. Now, you may think, well, that's a quaint cultural behavior. But if you extrapolated that sort of thinking to the way in which we actually conduct ourselves at present time, when there is this massive exploitation of both people and nature in the industrial agricultural system, to the extent that we actually degrade natural systems and turn food crops into non-food crops, into industrial uses, meaning that clearly we're thinking of ourselves and not really thinking of much else. Beyond that, you can see that there is a particular lesson from this particular behavior. There's a couple of other lessons from, actually, let me go back here so you can appreciate her. So this is another aunt, Lorenza Salvador, who just passed away last year. But The way that you learn the sorts of things that I'm describing to you are through harangues. So when I see Lorenza, what I think is all of the harangues, you know, that you just receive every time that there's opportunity, when you're sent out to do a chore, when you're going to go on a long trip, there's always, you know, some sort of sermon you have to put up with. And here's some examples of things that I remember and that my dad remembers from Lorenza. So she would always impress on us, and people of that generation would say, you always need to offer your help in everything that you're able. You don't just sit there, because that way you'll ensure that people will always recognize that you're there, you're a living being, you're considerate, and you will never go hungry because you're always helping. Here's another one. You need to collect, consume, and exchange everything that nature is actually giving you, but don't try to take away what she's not giving. This one we would hear when we would be out walking in the forest, and say you would walk past a fruit tree. Typically it'd be, you know, something succulent on a really hot day. And so Lorenza or people of that generation would say, if it's already fallen, if it's on the ground, then that tree is giving it to you. But if it's still on the tree, don't try to get up there. We were kids. Don't get up there and take it down, because she's not yet ready. She may not actually be giving it to you. So, you know, if on the surface value, I know that these things sound quaint, but if you think about what it reflects in terms of provisioning and thoughtfulness, not only for other human beings as well as for what's going on in nature and what needs to be regenerated, you can see that there's deep lessons there that apply universally. Here's one that I particularly appreciated: to conserve friendship, give away instead of lending, if you have it to give, and plant some of everything. Remember that a portion of it all will make good and be of use to you. You can see why to populations of people for whom we all are relatives and we're all each one another's social security, these types of deeply imbued cultural beliefs are actually the social capital of that group of people, reflected in relationships among people and with the natural world. Not applying these principles when we have almost indescribable power these days to manage nature without thinking about the long term has created today's reality that A, we create scarcity out of plenty, we produce too much, and we produce too much of the wrong stuff, with a primary indicator being, yes, we produce enough, and it's making us sick. It's killing us prematurely. So there's many decisions that are going wrong in the way that we're currently applying knowledge. If you want to learn a little bit more about some of these systems, there's a very nice book by Joyce Marcus and Clint Flannery, the anthropologist that I mentioned to you, that describes Zapotec civilization. And then there's this very nice piece of work by Roberto Gonzalez, which is called Zapotec Science, describing the development of this empirical knowledge, which turns into culture, the memory of what has worked and what doesn't work, and all the cultural tools that we have available for self-provisioning. Thank you for your attention.